So maybe tomorrow I'll find my way home.
Kelly Jones, welcome to Songbook.
Thank you.
And it's kind of appropriate in many ways that we're here at the Hay Festival because you were born not far from here.
Not far.
And here we are with you having got under your belt, massive string of hit singles, seven big albums, five number one records. I'm interested, right at the very beginning, to talk about the Welsh influence and the Welsh heritage in your music. And growing up in a small Welsh town, and your sort of childhood experience of that.
My dad was a singer, so I grew up following him around workingmen's clubs. He would give me a fiver to carry his speakers, and I mainly went for the Chinese takeaway on my own, to be honest. And, but you know, my old man, he had a small record deal with Polydor when I was a kid, well, before I was born, and he did some shows at Royal Orbison and stuff like that, and his record was on the jukebox in the local pub. So when I grew up, I was kind of, I had two older brothers who were 8 or 9 years older than me. They were listening to stuff like Creedence Clearwater Revival and the Eagles, Neil Young, Bob Dylan, all that kind of stuff. My old man was listening to Stevie Wonder and Sam Cooke, Otis Redding, Aretha Franklin. So I was brought up in quite a musical house.
And building up a record collection. Yeah. Well, what was the first single you bought?
My brother gave me Led Zeppelin 2. Mm-hmm. So that was the first record I inherited. And I remember walking down the street and that fell out of the sleeve and it went down a drain.
No!
So I had to dig that one back out. And then I was a massive AC/DC fan as a kid. So the first record I bought was in Woolworths and Aberdeen, which was Flick of the Switch, which was the follow-up to like Flo's Bird to Rock and all those big records. So I was a big rock fan, but I always loved a lot of the country music, you know, the Eagles and stuff like that, because that's what my brothers were playing in the bedroom.
At what point did you then sort of pick up a guitar and start? How did you do that? Did you start sort of playing along to the records you were hearing? Were you beginning to experiment with songwriting at that moment?
Yeah. My old man bought me my first guitar. He didn't ever push it on me. I don't think he wanted to force it on his kids to be necessarily into music. I think what happened was one Christmas there was a £10 nylon string acoustic guitar under the settee for Christmas, and if I want it, and have it, if you don't, then don't worry about it. So after about a year of not wanting it, I asked him could I have some lessons off his guitar player. So I started having lessons off him when I was about 10 or 11, and learning stuff like Pretty Woman, Roy Orbison and stuff like that. And then I ended up, Stuart the drummer was 7 doors up the road from me. He had a drum kit and he was about 4 years older than me. So he was practicing Highway to Hell by AC/DC in his bedroom and I was practicing in my bedroom so we could hear each other through 7 doors. And we decided this is a bit ridiculous, may as well go up the garage and play it together. So I did my first gig at 12 and Stuart was 15. And then we actually opened up with Bad Moon Rising. And then we went into Jump by Van Halen, then Hotel California. Then we did two of our own songs and finished with Wipeout and All Right Now by Free. And then we were asked to leave because we were too young to drink.
Yeah. was this the Working Men's Club?
Yeah, we rehearsed in a little kind of youth club at the end of that road every Thursday and Sunday for 10 years. And I don't know what kept us going there, but we sent 12 tapes away to record companies every Thursday and in pairs of shoes, trainers, Chinese cartons, cake boxes, anything to get them to open them. And they never opened them. And, we had many rejection letters and I've kept them all and sent them all back. It's been great. But I don't know, there's something that kind of... I was never really a great bedroom guitar player. I wasn't one to be in my room wanting to learn, you know, Jimi Hendrix riffs or... we did lots of covers and I learned them the day I was having to do them in the rehearsal room for the gig and stuff, but if I didn't write something within 10 minutes of picking up a guitar, then I used to put the guitar down. And I'm still like that, really. I mean, I'm quite disciplined in picking the guitar up, but I'm quite quick in putting it down if nothing happens pretty soon. And I just remember making up songs in the bath when I was a kid, you know, playing with your Action Man or whatever, but I just always remember just making up melodies in my head and And I think that's way before I could had any interest in learning an instrument or anything like that.
So easing your own songs then gradually into the band set. Well, describe the way that the band began to build then.
Well, when we first started, I wasn't really the songwriter in the band. There was another guy called Nicky Geek, and he was writing all the songs. And I was a kid, you know, I was 12, and they were all 16, 17. So, I mean, I had nothing to say about anything. I mean, I barely had hair downstairs, you know what I mean? So I had nothing to say. What I did, it was a great day, but So I was just in and out with all these different bands, loads of bad haircuts, loads of bad names. Nothing really changed much. And then we just kind of went in and out of all these different phases. You know, one week you'd be sounding like the Lemonheads, the next week you'd be like the Black Crowes, the next week you'd be like Pearl Jam or Jimi Hendrix, and just you weaving through all these cover versions, Beatles covers, and you know, Green Day or Nirvana, Bob Dylan, Neil Young. And I think by doing that for 9-10 years, by the time you start seriously writing your songs, I think you've learned so many chord progressions and changes and ways of playing songs. I think that comes through in your own way, but it comes through in your own way as yours, you know.
Yeah.
As opposed to if we'd been signed 4 years previous to when we did, we probably would have sounded like somebody else and dropped 3 years later.
But yes.
I think once you find your own track and you're kind of in, you know.
Because there's one influence on you at that time that I just want to pick out one name, and that's the Tragically Hip.
Yeah.
Edgy music.
Well, I was working in a market selling fruit and veg for 6 years, from 16 to the day I signed off. I shouldn't have been signing on, but I was signing on. And I was in art college. I went to college at 16 to do graphic design because I didn't want to get a job, because I thought if I get into a job, then nothing I want to do is ever going to come to anywhere, really. Because my brothers all worked in factories or they went in the army and stuff like that. I just knew how quick it could be to be kind of stuck in a rut, really. And so doing that, going to art college, it was an opportunity for me to kind of just take my time a bit and listen to music and work out what I wanted to do with the band. And bands like the Tragically Hip were writing very narrative songs. Very, you know, they came from a small town in Canada and they were writing very storytelling, descriptive, character-based songs, as was Neil Young and Dylan, and but also people like Elvis Costello. I love people like Tom Waits, you know, all that kind of Nick Cave. Anything that kind of told a story, really, because when I first started, I think I ended up doing like a HND in animation and filmmaking, and the animation thing drove me crazy because it's like 25 drawings a second, but the actual doing the idea of the story was intriguing. So I started writing lots of dialogue, and this was around the time Pulp Fiction, lots of Jimmy McGovern stuff on the TV, Our Friends in the North, you know, Chris Eccleston, Ian McEwan kind of stuff. And I think by me writing dialogue, that was when my lyric writing changed, because, you know, Billy Davies' daughter, a local boy in a photograph, she takes her clothes off. All those started off as scripts.
Yeah.
And ironically, just before I got a record deal, BBC offered me a job to write scripts, and Richard Branson offered me a record deal the same month. So I picked the rock and roll first, and then go back to it. But I think it all started from an interest in drama and those bands, but also in dialogue and listening to people talking and stuff, yeah.
You mentioned Local Boy in the Photograph, which was your first hit single. Tell us about the inspiration behind the song, Kelly.
I used to play kind of county football with Mick Glamorgan and kind of Valley, and there was a kid who used to play right back. And I got to know him really well. He was a really cool kid, and he was a good-looking kid, and he was kind of one of those ones you looked at and thought, you know, he's got it all kind of thing. And then a few years later, we found out he jumped in front of a train. And we were all a bit shocked by it. And then we read about it in the local paper, and there was a picture of him smoking which I think was a joint, actually. And that's the picture they used, and he was a local boy in the photograph. And it was just, I'd never really known anybody our age to do that, to kind of end their life, and nobody really knew why he ended his life. And when you're 18 or 19, you're quite naive and you just write everything down. And it was just more about a celebration of his life than it was about his death, really, about the kids sitting on the bank drinking and lots of imagery about the seasons and the clocks going back. And I think that's where I found that descriptive writing became what people would stop and listen to, really.
We should hear it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. No mistake, I smell that smell. It's that time of year again. I can taste the air. Your clocks go back, railway track. Something blocks the line again, and the train. A pebble beach, we're underneath a pier just been painted red. Where I heard the news for the first time. And drink for hours, talk of the way they saw him last, local boy in the photograph today. He'll always be 23, yet the train runs on and on.
So Kelly, the word gets around, album's out. You're starting to tour, taking the band and the songs out to bigger venues.
Yeah.
The pace of life, presumably now, is beginning to really quicken.
Yeah.
So then the adjustment into all of this, from where you were to where you're clearly now going, how are you sort of getting your brain around all this at the time?
Well, it was a bit weird. It was a quite quick transition. I moved out of my mum and dad's house because the first album I was still living with my mum and dad's, and then you buy a first house, and then you travel around the world with your friends. Going to New York for the first time, in LA for the first time, in Europe and Japan, and we were still only 24, and we employed all our mates as our crew, and it was a tragedy, really. I mean, the gig got in the way of the bender, to be honest with you. But we had a good time.
Good fun, though, isn't it? Yeah, absolutely.
It was a great time. I was writing songs in my bunk, and they were downstairs playing FIFA. And I think that's when my writing style changed. I just realised if I started to try and play guitar, I mean, the first album is all, I never really went past the third fret, you know, it was all chords. And I thought when I come to the second record, if I started playing guitar in a slightly different way, and also lyrically, you know, I was seeing more things and experiencing more things and being tempted by more things and all sorts of things in life, which I'd never really had where I'd been living before. So I think it was the first time I stepped outside of 100% observational writing and putting a lot more of me into the songs, asking questions for the first time, like Hurry Up and Wait and Just Looking and Pick Apart This New, all those songs, they're all kind of asking where am I supposed to be, and you know, that kind of mid-20s life crisis situation where you don't really know what you're doing, why you're doing it, who you are. And I think that comes through subconsciously a lot in that album.
And suddenly now the circumstances of writing has changed completely, and you know, obviously in two ways. First of all, widening of experience, but also the space and time that you've got to chisel for yourself to make songwriting happen. Because, you know, with all the work on the road and everything else, Kelly, I mean, I don't know how you are with writing on the road. Can you write on the road?
Yeah, I do most of my writing on the road. What tends to happen is you have 12 years of rehearsals and then you get your first album and then you never rehearse ever again.
Yes.
You know, your rehearsal's going to come on stage and and sound checks. And so if I didn't take on the role of becoming the kind of lead songwriter as opposed to us jamming songs in a room, then the songs wouldn't really have a chance to happen, really.
So then capturing the ideas as they're arriving, Kelly, I mean, you know, when you first started writing, presumably if you wanted to record anything just quickly as a demo, you put it onto a cassette or... But of course the technology of capturing material now has changed.
It's weird you say that. If you've got my bag in the dressing room, there's a cassette player in there because I still stick it on a cassette.
Do you?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, there are opportunities now, aren't there, for loads of, like, mini studios?
Exactly. You can use the garage band thing and digital recorders and stuff, but when the batteries run out, you freak out, everything's gone. But when you've got a cassette, I mean, you just got to keep it away from your kids because they tape over it all the time. I was really good at recording ideas and, you know, Performance and Cocktails especially, which became, you know, a really, really big record. I mean, Word Gets Around didn't go platinum till Performance and Cocktails went platinum, so the band wasn't really that big, it was on a curve. And then I realised 3 days before going into a box in Bath, Peter Gabriel's studio, to record Performance and Cocktails, that I didn't really think I had many songs. And but then I realised I had listened to 3 whole cassettes worth of ideas, and I'm good at recording them, but I never used to listen back to them. And the day before I listened back, I played it, and I found Bartender and the Thief, and then I found Just Looking, and then I found Stop the Fill My Car Up, and I thought, I've got quite a few songs, actually. And then we went in the studio, and they all came out pretty good.
So the second album then, Kelly, Performance and Cocktails, what are you going to play for us from that?
Well, Just Looking was a song I wrote in a hotel room in Amsterdam, and I didn't want to go to sleep, so I just started writing songs. And Just Looking literally started, it was called The List, because it just says the things I want, there's things I think I want, there's things I've had, there's things I want. And then I just had a song called Goldfish Bowl, which was... and I started nicking off myself already by the second album. This will come into the whole thing later on, but I've nicked many songs off myself. And Just Looking just became that slowed down, really, so... I'll play that for you.
There's things I want, there's things I think I want, there's things I've had, there's things I do. I want the dreams, the ones we're forced to see. Do I want the perfect wife? Well, perfect ain't quite right. Shopping every day, take it back the next break. They say the more you fly, the more you risk your life. smiling, the house I sin. Another could have been. You drenched my head and said what I said. You said that life is what you make of it, yet most of us just fake, and I'm just looking. I'm not buying. I'm just looking. Keeps me smiling.
Kelly Jones with me here at the Hay Festival. So can I ask you about the songwriting process, Kelly? I mean, and your particular way of writing.
I think 90% of the songs I've written is usually like a chord progression and a melody, and then I'll go and fill in the words later. And then sometimes a key line will come out, and then you'll go back and try to make a whole song make sense to that one line that's come from your subconscious. And then some songs you just want to get something off your chest, and you can write 9 verses, and then you put music to that. I think the first record, it kind of came very, very natural to me. I didn't really care what anybody thought about the songs. I knew they were songs that meant something to me, and I knew they were important. And then it comes to your second record, you still keep that, but then you know there's a kind of silent pressure that you have to live up to your last record. And there's a workload to maintain at the same time by touring the world, so then you have to apply discipline to your work.
Yes.
Actually having to do it, as well as go out with all the boys all the night and do all that and then come back and do the song. So you find all these different patterns in your life, and I think for me, if you keep the tap dripping, then you can always continue to write. A lot of writers, they stop when they go on a world tour, which could sometimes last for 15 months. I mean, if you're a swimmer or you're a football player or you're an athlete, if you stop anything for 50 months, getting back into it, it takes you 6 months before you even start.
Absolutely.
So for me, I always just figured if I just keep doing it, it's a bit like the Walt Disney thing. You can do 1,000 shit drawings before you do a good one. And there's a million shit songs on my tape. So you just keep somehow doing it. And it's tiring sometimes, in the sense of you're just going through and you just think, the end of every album, you start writing for the new one, you think there's nothing left, it's coming out, and then bit by bit, you know, you write one, then you have a little niche, and then all of a sudden it starts again, and it's quite amazing how where they come from, really.
Pick a part that's new. Just describe this process to us, specifically with that song.
Well, pick a part that's new. It was the first time I'd ever been to New York. We just played Reading Festival, and we were all going to go there for the first time together, and we stayed in Gramercy Park Hotel, and you know, coming from Camham and going to the Gramercy Park Hotel was quite a big leap for us. And it was a bit like Kojak and all that, you know, it was these phones with the push buttons on it, and you look out the windows, all the yellow cabs. It was that guy at the bar, like a Charles Bukowski story. It was everything that we ever thought it would be, really. So I think that was just the first impressions of New York for us, and I think musically it was influenced a bit by Smashing Pumpkins and just trying to write riffs in a different way on the guitar, and it came quite simple. So, do you want me to play that?
Yeah.
weeks ago, never met you before. I've never been to your home that smells not unknown. Footsteps made of stone. Walking feels familiar.
Kelly, you're now working towards the fourth album.
Yeah.
And I think you got to go there to come back. To what extent now does this title explain a bit in itself what was happening to you at that time? Because, you know, fame has this habit, doesn't it, of sort of whooshing you up into this whirlwind. And at some stage or another, you have to make a decision to just surrender to it and go with it for a while, haven't you? To have a really good look at it.
Yeah.
You kind of got to go there and let to get a handle on it, get a take on it, and then come back.
Well, it was, you know, just enough education to perform became our biggest record. I mean, the summer that hit its peak was 2003, and we headlined Glastonbury, we headlined V Festival, we headlined Slane Castle. I mean, we did a massive arena tour. It was just ridiculous, really. It couldn't get much bigger. And unless somebody showed me the footage, I wouldn't quite believe it all happened. It was so fast. And so then when you go back into the studio, after having such a really, you know, successful 2 years, we locked ourselves away in a house for 12 weeks in Henley, and you know, the drinks bill was more expensive than the tapes. And we had a good time, and it became a lot more of a bluesy record, a lot more soulful record, a lot more searching, a lot more of a personal record. And in many sense, it became, in some ways, not a breakup record, but I just ended the relationship I'd had since I was 14 in Wales, and it was the first time I moved to London. So it was almost like in a new environment with a new partner, in a new situation. But what comes with all that is the baggage of what you've left behind, kind of thing. And I think when I first started writing the record, I was in a bit of a slump, because I had nobody around me that I knew. Nobody I knew lived in London. And it was quite an isolated situation, really. And I think, you know, songs like Maybe Tomorrow and Miss You Now and Since I Told You It's Over, all those kind of songs, and Rainbows and Pots of Gold, it was pretty much an album that just kind of poured out, really.
Yeah.
Which I'd never experienced in that kind of...
I would love to hear Maybe Tomorrow, actually, as we're talking
Maybe Tomorrow
about that
came
moment,
from,
yeah.
We did a John Lennon tribute show with Noel Gallagher, and we covered I'm Only Sleeping. And by covering I'm Only Sleeping with those chords, I mean, I'd never played an E-flat on a guitar in my life. So by doing that, I nicked all those chords and changed the order of it. And I think also, do you remember that program, The Littlest Hobo, with the dog? Maybe tomorrow I wanna settle down, all that. I think I had that in the back of my head as well. So all these things, and that song Summer Breeze, I wanted to write a song that sounded like, I think if you can write a song, if the words sound like how it makes you feel, like the word sponge sounds like sponge and splash and velvet, there's certain words that sound exactly like what they are. And I think if you can write a song that can make you feel exactly what the words are doing, then I think you kind of onto something. So, this was Maybe Tomorrow.
Kelly Jones is with us. We're here at the Hay Festival for Songbooks. And, there's a phrase that a lot of American musicians, particularly younger musicians, Kelly, the phrase a lot of them use, you know, that we're building our fan base one fan at a time. And I always think this kind of applies also to the Stereophonics.
Yeah.
Because I always thought that was your kind of modus operandi.
Yeah.
You watched, didn't you, over those few years, from smaller venues to bigger venues to stadiums to, you know, Wembley and all this kind of stuff. So, you know, in terms of the writing then and the projection of the songs, did you begin to find yourself perhaps sometimes writing for a big stadium? Did that come into your mind?
You know, people were saying when we first came out, when Local Boy first came out, that the phrase that was in like Melody Maker, Enemy, everything was, they'll be stadium sized by the millennium. So the songs we were writing anyway, like Local Boy and Traffic and Bartender and The Thief, all these songs, they fitted so well in the festival environment. It wasn't like we went away to try to write more anthemic songs the bigger the room got. It's almost like the songs took us to those rooms because those songs were too big for the clubs in a way. So I never sat down trying to cater to the stature the band was becoming. It was just kind of doing that by itself. If anything, it was pulling it back, because on Jeep we pulled it all back to like an acoustic record after becoming stadium size. We stripped it away in a way, you know.
Yeah. So then did it impact on the production of the records then? Did you eventually sort of begin to look for a more intimate sound?
Well, I think what started happening on the tour of You Gotta Go That's Come Back, we were touring across America, we were touring with David Bowie, we were touring with everybody really, and we ended up with a band that we didn't really know who was in the band anymore. We had an extra guitar player, we had three gospel singers. It was like eight of us traveling across America. It was costing a fortune. Our manager was losing interest in what we were doing. We'd kind of lost our identity, really. I mean, we'd lost the Radio 1 thing. The songs had become too soulful and too adult for where we were at, in a way. And we did a festival in Japan called Summer Sonic, and we were touring with the Strokes. And I stood on the side of the stage watching the Strokes, and for a long time, I was quite scared and frightened, but not many bands have ever scared me, but I was watching them at the side of the stage and they looked like a band. There was five of them on stage. I mean, they were at their peak and they looked the bollocks, they sounded great, and I realised that we'd crossed a line and we'd lost who we were. I'd been writing all these songs on the road and I realised that we need to pull it back as a three-piece and start it again, really, and that was the Language, Sex, Violence, other album. And you know, I wrote Dakota and Superman and all these tracks on the road, and I wanted all of them to be one-word song titles and really modern artwork and just re-identify the band as this modern rock band, which is what we started out to be.
So tell us about Dakota then and how that song came about.
I remember being on a promo trip in Paris and I was writing some songs in a hotel room and I couldn't find any songs again, and I started playing Traffic fast, which was like... which again was influenced by the Strokes thing, because everything they play was eights.
Yeah.
It was all that, and the guitar player played his guitar like a Space Invader, so that's where... which was like the main hook riff in that. And I mean, I was so confident in that song that night, even though I hadn't written any words for it, but the line "You Made Me Feel Like the One" came out. I texted the head of the label of V2 and said, I think I've got the one, kind of thing. And I've never had that experience before, and I've never had it since. And that was kind of the new beginning for the band, really, because then it was 14-year-old kids in the front row who thought that was our first single, and then you have a complete resurgence, and then it all takes off on the second kind of chapter, you know.
And what a great groove. Play it for us, Kelly. Okay. I'd love to hear that.
Thinking back, thinking of you. Summertime, I think it was June. Yeah, I think it was June. Laying back, head on the grass. Chewing gum, having some laughs. Yeah, having some laughs. You made me feel like the one. Feel like the one. You made me feel like the one. Made me feel like the one. Drinking back, drinking for two. Drinking with you. drinking was new. Sleeping in the back of my car, we never went far. We didn't need to go far. You made me feel like the one, made me feel like the one, the one. You made me feel like the one, made me feel like the one, the one. Coffee and juice, remembering you, what happened to you. I wonder if we'll meet again, talk about life since then, talk about why did it end. You made me feel like the one, made me feel the one. You made me feel like the one, made me feel like the one, the one. I don't know where we are going now.
See, there's an amazing thing, you know, just sitting here now, Kelly, listening to you playing these songs. I mean, you know, you're talking about the sort of maelstrom and that moment where you were at a crossroads and Dakota became a new sort of springboard, didn't it? Do you think, okay, under the sort of general heading of body of work, if you like, do you think that there might have been a stage, therefore, when the Stereophonics were kind of taken for granted or you know, that it's only now, in a way, looking back over all of these songs, that the writing craft has become to be more appreciated, and the people are realizing what a good lyricist, in particular, you are.
Well, I think, you know, when you're in a band, certain scenes get overlooked by certain things that are happening at the time, really. And I think for Stereophonics, I mean, I said some stupid things, I mean, for the first couple of records in the press, I mean, but irony doesn't come across in print a lot of the time, and we swore a lot, and we came across very angry, but we were actually quite happy. And so the band has had definitely a kind of uphill struggle to get critical appreciation. I mean, the last album, Keep Calm and Carry On, are the best reviews we've had since Word Gets Around, which was, you know, the Times said it's the best record we ever made, and it's just quite... The minute you stop caring, it all kind of comes back to you in a way. It's quite not stop caring about what you do, but stop caring about what people think about it.
Yeah.
And I mean, even songs like that. I mean, when I go back and listen to it now, you know, when it says "Summertime," I think it was June. Yeah, I think it was June. That's completely nicked from "Common People" by Pulp. You know, when he says, "Yeah, I think it was." and you just you steal all these little things from people, and you don't realise you're doing it. And there's a lot of great artists that never really get the recognition, and but I don't really lose much sleep over that. I mean, I try to just make records that appeal to me and appeal to the boys in the band, and when you go on the road, they appeal to the people coming to watch us, and that grows and grows and grows, you know.
Brilliant. I've enjoyed it so much. This has been fantastic. Ladies and gentlemen, Kelly Jones.
Make it easy for you.
Yes.